Hi, folks. In the spirit of releasing shows on people's birthdays, I'd like to wish a very happy birthday to Frank Sinatra.
Yours too, asshole.
Yeah, it is that too.
So I got something really special for you.
No. Oh, really? Okay. All right, folks, welcome back. This is Corey.
And this is Dave.
And this is Scott. Praise Satan.
Praise Satan.
Praise. Mm-hmm. Praise Satan, yum. Indeed.
And
yes.
And tongue it.
So, welcome back to Musical Shenanigans, doing what it is we do. Dave?
Yes, doing what it is we do. So, if you're new to the show, or if you just are maybe a prior listener and just need a recap, so here's what we're doing. We have taken the Rolling Stones list of 500 greatest albums of all time, and we randomly select 192 of those, which we seeded into a bracket, and we have been pitting them head to head. So in each round, what we have is two albums go in, one album comes out. We debate the relative merits of each album. We take a vote. We declare a winner. The winner moves on to the next round. The loser is done. And we are going to keep doing this until ultimately the three of us come up with our selection for greatest album of all time. So, Corey, you want to tell us about our first matchup for the day?
Yep. So we have two matchups per show. And the first matchup is going to be Hole, Live Through This. Taking on Jeff Buckley's Grace. And without any nonsense from me, we're just going to go straight
into that hole. Right in. It's wide open. You could drive a truck in there. Well, so much could be said about Courtney Love. But let's kind of focus on the album. This was recorded while Cobain was still alive, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, they were still alive. They were still married.
And they said he actually ghost wrote a couple of songs.
Yeah, there was this rumor out there that some of these songs, and I remember hearing it when this album came out. I remember hearing the rumor that Kurt Cobain had really written all these songs. And yeah. Courtney Love pretty strongly denied that. And it's actually kind of funny. I like the way she denied it. She basically said, look, he's better than I am. If he had written them, the songs would have been better, which I frankly, my personal view is I tend to agree, actually. But it is a good album.
It is.
And Kurt did do backup vocals. Oh, right. And when he showed up to the studio in Atlanta, they said, hey, can you do some backing vocals for on these tracks? He immediately said, well, I don't know what any of these songs are, which to me is the wrong answer. Any musician goes, all right, play it through. I'll see what I can do for you. He was just a little too defensive too quickly.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, interesting. Interesting. So you think that was a little bit of a tell that maybe he did have a hand in some of these?
I think so. I think that a couple of the songs just kind of have his feel to it. Even Doll Parts could have been a Nirvana song.
You know why I kind of disagree with that? Because I really do kind of give into this that comment that I made earlier about how Cobain was the better writer. As I listened to this, and I actually listened to this one twice coming into this, it's a good album, but Cobain's writing could be, it could be a little bit, you had to think about it a little bit to sort of sometimes see what he was going for, but you could always sort of suss out what he was going for. Courtney Love's writing is not the same. There's a lot of this, the lyrics on this, where it's like, okay, I get that she's using a lot of imagery. Like you hear, there's a ton of songs that refer to milk over and over again. But it's a lot less accessible than Cobain's lyric writing. A lot of these songs, I listen to for 3 minutes and have no fucking idea by the end of the song what the hell she was singing about.
I agree there, definitely.
Yeah, I don't think he was responsible for any lyrics. I think he was responsible for music.
Oh.
Yes. Yeah, I was just going to say, Corey, that to me, the music seems definitely, some of the guitar riffs are definitely more Nirvana-esque.
Well, that's why I said doll parts, so, not the lyrics, but right, definitely right. that riff, that whole, the whole feel of that song was just, I don't know, it gave me a Nirvana vibe. It gave me a Kurt vibe.
I'm sure the words are all hers. They sound very Courtney. It's like, I'm a heroin whore. Oh.
You know, I think the other thing that probably partly fed that rumor is the timing of this, because this album came out 4 days after Cobain had shot himself. And so Cobain was in the news, you know, for at least in music circles, was in the news for weeks afterwards, of course, because he killed himself pretty violently, to the point where even there was this conspiracy theory for a while that maybe actually Courtney Love had killed him and faked his suicide.
Right.
And so I kind of feel like maybe that sort of fed into the rumor, too, just because Cobain's name was so out there at the time. People wanted to believe that he ghostwritten it just so they could tell themselves there was another hidden Nirvana album out there, basically.
I felt like maybe they could have waited for the release. I don't know. They're in the business. Kurt's name is in the press. She's the widow. She has a new album, and they're going to run with it. It's going to make money.
It got her a lot of press.
That's true.
Yes.
Be that good or bad, it was there. You know, as they say, any press is good press. So.
I would actually like suggest that this is a good album, but I don't know if it would have gone quite as far had it not been for the whole Kurt Cobain suicide.
Probably not. And just the fact he was married to her as well.
Which kind of sucks for her, because I will say that, like, for my criticisms of the lyrics earlier, you know, she was a talented songwriter. I presumably she still is. I haven't heard her make music in a while. But she was a talented songwriter, and she did kind of have to live in his shadow, because he was basically, in the early 90s, Kurt Cobain was sort of like the God savior of music for a lot of people. So
very true. Very true.
So I do think she had it a little bit rough, not just for the inherent sexism in the industry, but also for sort of, you know, having to deal with being not her own person, but rather constantly seen as Kurt Cobain's wife.
Right, right. And she's the widow of Cobain, right. So she's got to be okay.
I will say, even though I think that Kurt probably helped with a couple of these, like, musically, but the lyrics, I mean, they are personal and they're raw.
Mm-hmm. They are.
And there's something to be said about that. I think we always agree that if something has a raw sound and not overly produced, it's... Mm. We're going to like it better.
Isn't that funny?
One of the tracks on this is called, I forget what it's called. It's like the last track, Rock and Roll Star or something like that. I wanted to say it was called Olympia, but I just realized that, like, she just says over and over again that she grew up in Olympia and she went to school in Olympia. And it's sort of a commentary on the whole sort of music scene and everything was coming out of Washington at the time. And it's funny that when I got to that, I was reminded of conversations that we've had about Slater Kinney, because really Courtney Love and Hole were doing a lot of the same thing, in the sense that they were using sort of a punk sound with feminist themes and sort of talking about how hard it is to be a woman in the music industry and in society just generally. But the difference is, did it way better than Slater Kinney. In my opinion, I've had my criticisms of Sleater-Kinney in the past. The anger here is much more at the surface, and so it's really much more of a true punk album than Sleater-Kinney.
The anger is palpable. The other joke about Courtney Love is the album is, you know, it sounds like the producers that make the album. So as much as, you know, kind of Kurt's the ghostwriter here, it has a little bit of her sound, but the producers, Paul Q. Caldari and Sean Slade, also worked with Pixies, Radiohead, Dinosaur Jr., yeah. And this album kind of has that sound, whereas, like, her next album, it's Billy Corgan, And they say, well, that's her Smashing Pumpkins album.
There were a couple of points in this where I was thinking, God, this sounds right. like Pixies. And I didn't find out until after the fact, actually, that there was a tie in there. All right. What else do we have to say about Courtney Hole? Anything else?
Courtney Hole love. Courtney's love hole. Oh, well, Courtney's love hole was quite... She doesn't get to go on the rocket. I mean, she kind of deserves to be on the rocket, but not really.
I kind of reassessed her. As I was listening to this, I really kind of took a negative view of Courtney Love for a lot of years. But actually, when we were prepping for the show and I was doing a lot of the reading about some of the struggles she had and really how hard she worked to try to make a name for herself completely independently of Kurt, I don't know, a little bit more respect for her maybe than I had before, to be perfectly honest.
She raised money to record their first demo by stripping.
Go her. I mean, you know, I mean that.
Yeah, I mean, she originally wanted to name the band Sweet Baby Crystal Powered by God.
Yeah.
That's a mouthful.
That looks good on a flyer.
Yeah. But then she said Hole came because she was inspired by the Euripides quote from Medea, "There's a hole that pierces right through me."
That's cool.
Her mom used to say she couldn't live her life with a hole running through her. And then, of course, the obvious genital reference that we've been playing on this whole
time.
Well,
yeah, I think that's...
Like, we have a choice?
I think that's what most people assumed it meant, honestly, when the band came out.
Right.
It had a deeper meaning.
Oh, things get dark quickly.
When you're in a hole. Jeff Buckley's Grace. Let's talk about Jeff Buckley.
He's dead.
Jeff Buckley, I think...
What a dipshit.
The bigger story behind this is Jeff Buckley's life. It's not only this album, because it's the only album he really did. There are others that have come out. There's live things that he did. There's other things that his own mother has put out posthumously. He died, quote-unquote, accidentally, through an impulsive swim in the Mississippi River, fully clothed. But I'm going to come back to that. So, his father, Tim Buckley... He met him only once when he was 8 years old. That was also a singer-songwriter. They spent a week together when he was 8. And not too long after that, his dad passed away at 28. Jeff grew up with music in his life. His mother's a classically trained pianist and cellist. And his stepfather shared his Zeppelin albums, Queen, Hendrix, The Who, and Pink Floyd with him. The first album he ever owned was a Led Zeppelin album, Physical Graffiti. So he started the guitar at 5. And by the time he's in high school, he's already listened to prog rock. He says... He wants to be a musician. So let's fast forward to 91. He landed a gig where every Monday night at this club called Cine, I don't know how it's pronounced. He did eclectic covers from Zeppelin, Dylan, Elton John, The Smiths, Bad Brains, Susie Sue. So I mention this because we now get to the album Grace, an album that is eclectic by every mean, because this album is literally all over the place. Yeah. And of course, it was complimented by the likes of Jimmy Page, Robert Plant, David Bowie, saying, you know, it's one of the 10 albums he would have on a desert island. He got a lot of great accolades for this. So now let's go back to the night in Memphis. He's preparing to create a follow-up to Grace. And if the name hadn't already been taken, the perfect name for the second album would have probably been Grace Under Pressure. 3 years after touring, his recording label is telling him, we need a follow-up. We need another album. So he's on edge. He's upset. He's shaky, according to his friends. He wanted to be as good as his father is another comment he made, because now he's 30 years old. His dad died at 28. He's got death on the mind. And he goes out into the Mississippi. He's singing Whole Lot of Love. So I call you back to Led Zeppelin being the first album he owned. And we look at some of the lyrics on a couple of these songs on this album. Dream Brother. The lyrics say, asleep in the sand with the ocean washing over. And in the song eternal life is now on my tail. Got red glitter coffin, man. Just need one last nail. So I say to you, as Elliot Smith's murder was called a suicide, Jeff Buckley's suicide was ruled an accidental death.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what are you saying? Well, no, he was an interesting dude. In that respect.
But getting to this album, it is all over the place. And I think that it is because he pulled in everything. Everything he ever listened to is in here somewhere.
It is. And there's probably no better example of that than one of the tracks is Corpus Christi Carol, which is a old religious song that dates from the 15th century that Benjamin Britten reworked in 1930s and came up with a more sort of more modern English version, but still basically the same song. And to hear Buckley go from, first he goes, there are rock songs in this album, there are like sort of slow torch songs on this album, and then all of a sudden he launches into this melody that is a medieval church music, basically. It's almost hard to wrap your head around, and frankly, I think in some ways, it's actually one of the drawbacks of the album. He's trying to do so much, and he's so all over the place here, that there's really no sort of consistent theme. If we're judging this as an album as a whole, there's no sort of consistent overarching theme or mood to the whole thing. You know what I mean?
It's very distracting.
Yeah.
If this was an album that said by various artists, that'd be a different story. But you're right, Torch Song. Exactly. It's like all of a sudden he's channeling Judy Garland.
Yeah, the whole thing just certainly doesn't have any cohesiveness. But I mean, the thing that does blend it, though, is his voice.
The guy could sing.
And he could definitely sing. I don't care for that falsetto sound. Just not my thing.
No, you're not alone, actually. I when I was doing prep for this show, I actually found an article online by a guy named Simon Sweetman, who I don't know who that is, but I give him a shout out because it's his quote, not mine. He said, Jeff Buckley's voice, quote, sounds like Eddie Vedder cured his laryngitis, but only by gargling Led Zeppelin albums while drinking down total asshole juice.
That's
so it's
good.
Not for everybody, in other words.
It's not.
No.
At the same time, another artist, Duncan Sheik, came out with his first album that had kind of the same voice, but it wasn't as annoying. This one was like, okay, he kept doing it. And it's like, your vocal range where you should be is beautiful. It's great. Stay there, will you?
That's true.
Please.
That's true.
I listened to it multiple times. I kept trying to find someone like David Bowie wants this as a desert island album. Maybe it's because it's eclectic and all over the place. Maybe because there's something else that you can find on each subsequent listen. There is that, but to me, it's a distraction.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I
there's no accounting for taste, Mr. Bowie.
Yeah. I mean, Scott, you used the right word. The word that I was searching for earlier is coherence, and it's just not there. And so if we're judging this as an album whole, for me, that's a downside. I also think, you know, I said earlier that I think maybe the whole album got a little bit of a boost from Cobain's death. I don't know if this album would have sold as many copies had it not been for the fact that this guy, you know, dies in a tragic, possibly accident in at the age of 30.
Weird boating accident or swimming.
Swimming. With his clothes on, with his boots on, and he's wading out in the water. The guy, and his, like, you know, his roadie that's with him is on the shore screaming at him, telling him this is stupid.
They said the autopsy showed no drugs or alcohol.
Slight trace of alcohol, but not enough to have like completely hindered him in the water.
Yeah, crazy.
Yeah, and at
crazy
the time stuff. He was, you know, Corey, you mentioned he was working on a follow-up of the album, and he was actually working with another artist we've talked about before, Tom Verlaine from Television, who, as we previously established,
is an asshole.
Yeah. The other drawback of this album, and I don't really blame Buckley for this, but there is a version of Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah on here, which is actually, out of the thousands of versions of that song, this is probably one of the better ones.
It really is.
However, I will tell you, as somebody, so I have a background on me. I spent some time in the theater world back when I was in college. If you are a young actor or actress who is getting ready to audition for the musical and you come in and sing Hallelujah, I'm going to get out of my chair and walk across the room and slap the shit out of you. Every actor and actress wants to do it as their audition piece. It's, you can't do it. You cannot do it justice the way Jeff Buckley did. Stop. Find something else. There have been enough versions of Hallelujah. We're all full here. Thank you.
You know, when you said that, Dave, I just imagined you as a Michael Douglas in a chorus line, storming up to the stage, or into this, like, third stanza by the time he gets up on stage. They're singing, and he just slaps them.
The difference is I hate musicals, so I'd never direct one in the first place, but...
It's time to sink this round. All right, Scott, you vote first.
Hello, benevolent Satan here. Scott has been quiet for the past 4 minutes. Because he stopped recording at that point, and everything forward is absolutely Clementine. Therefore, I am going to let you know, in my benevolence and omnipotence, what his vote would be. First, he would tell you how listening to Jeff Buckley made him want to slam his dick in the door. Ahem. Slam his dick in the door.
Right. Sorry.
Thank you. And that his vote would be for Dearest Courtney and her ban hole. By the way, Kurt says hi. Now on with the rest of the votes.
Okay, I'm second, and I'm also, I'm going to give it to Courtney.
All right, well, doesn't really matter then what I think, but the interesting thing for me is I listened to both of these twice. I actually didn't love either one of them the first listen, and on the second listen, they both grew on me a little bit, and I think, on the whole, for me, actually, it would have been the Jeff Buckley album, but again, doesn't matter because it's already decided.
I considered it, but there was just, it's too much hype. I felt like Courtney really gave something personal of herself on that.
Yes.
Despite the timing and all.
That's true.
Okay. Well, hello there, folks. This is the end of the show. You will have to come back another time for the other half when we will try to re-release our discussion on Joni Mitchell and Janis Joplin. Because Scott's recording, as Satan told you, is absolutely gone and cannot be retrieved. Use this time to reclaim some of your life back, and we'll have another show out for you soon. Merry holidays. Praise Satan. Don't get run over.